All praise is due to Allah, and may Allah raise the rank of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and protect his nation from that which he fears for them. Dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let us first have the proper intention in our hearts to attend the lesson for the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In our previous lesson, we spoke about the integrals of wudu, or the obligations of wudu. Then the recommended matters in wudu. So if one were to gain the full amount of rewards when performing wudu, let him be keen to perform the obligations and the recommended matters as well. And since we have started the month of Sha'ban, and we're drawing closer to the month of Ramadan, we are going to start with the chapter of fasting from the book of Al-Qadi Abu Shuja', known as Al-Ghaya wa Taqrib. We have mentioned that Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' is one of the famous scholars of the Shafi'i school. He is a prominent scholar, famous in the school of Imam Al-Shafi'i radiyallahu anhu. And he authored this book called Al-Ghaya wa Taqrib, in which he explained the rules of the religion according to the school of Imam Al-Shafi'i radiyallahu anhu. So we are explaining this book, and in some cases we mention what other scholars said regarding these cases, where we find that it should be mentioned, we mention what other scholars from other schools of Islamic jurisprudence mentioned about this case. So the chapter of fasting. The author said, the conditions for the obligation of fasting are three. Al-Islam, being a Muslim, pubescence, and sanity. So here Al-Qadi Abu Shuja' mentioned these three conditions. In order for one to be obligated to fast, he's saying he must be Muslim, pubescent, and sane. And of course he didn't mention the ability to fast, which should be added. So Muslim, pubescent, sane, and able to fast. And we are going to explain this, inshallah, in detail. As-Sawm, fasting, linguistically means to abstain from something. So if you stay away from something, you abstain, refrain from it, that means you are fasting from it. Maryam alayha salam, when she went out looking for water one day, and she saw angel Jibreel alayhi salam, and he told her, he gave her the good tidings that she will be pregnant with an elite child who will be a prophet and pious and righteous. And she exclaimed, how could she fall pregnant and she's not married and she's not a fornicator? And Jibreel told her that this is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed to happen to you and it won't be revoked. So she surrendered to the will of Allah azza wa jal, to what Allah azza wa jal predestined for her. But she knew, as a matter of fact, that when she's gonna come back to her people carrying a child who is her child and she's not married, they're gonna accuse her of fornication. So she was worried about this. Jibreel alayhi salam gave her the solution for this manner. Because once she's gonna come back to her people with a child in her hands, they're gonna accuse her of fornication. Jibreel alayhi salam told her to fast from talking. In the previous nations, they used to fast from talking as well. A person would make a vow not to talk to people for one day, or 2 days, or 3 days. So Maryam alayha salam made that vow that she won't talk to people. So when she gave birth to Prophet Isa alayhi salam, and she carried him, and she brought him to her people, as she expected, they bombarded her with the accusations. They said, or they used very abusive language against her. Something that is very hurtful. One of them is that, for instance, they said, Ya Ukhta Harun. And this is out of sarcasm they were saying. She's not the actual sister of Harun, but they meant by purity. But they are insinuating that she's not pure. So they said, Ya Ukhta Harun, Ma kana abuki imra'a saw'in, wa ma kanat ummuki baghiya. Your father wasn't a bad person, and your mom wasn't an adulteress. So they are insinuating that she is, Maryam is. She didn't talk to them. Because she already told them that she had made a vow not to talk to them before. So she's fasting from talking. All what she did, she pointed by her head to her child, meaning talk to him. And here they thought she is mocking them. And they said, how could we talk to just newborn baby? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enabled Prophet Isa alayhi salam at that age to talk 40 days. And he spoke with their language and he told them that he will be a prophet, that he is a slave of Allah, and he will be given a book will be revealed to him, and he will be a prophet, and he will be very kind to his mother, and so on. So they used to fast from talking. Fasting is to abstain from something. Islamically, it's a specific abstination from a specific person in a specific time with conditions. That's the definition of fasting Islamically. They say, imsakun makhsus min shakhsin makhsus fi waqtin makhsus bi shara'it. So it's a specific type of abstination. From what? You abstain from certain things that would invalidate your fast if you were to do one. Fasting has been confirmed in the Quran, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the scholarly consensus. In the Quran, Allah Ta'ala said, Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu kutiba alaykumu s-siyam kama kutiba ala allatheena min qablikum la'allakum tattaqoon. Meaning, all you who believe, fasting has been ordained upon you as an obligation, as it has been ordained upon the previous nations, so you may become pious. So fasting actually helps you. Fasting helps you become pious. So this ayah clearly shows that fasting has been ordained as an obligation upon us. That's in the Quran. Another verse, Allah Ta'ala said, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْهُ. Whoever witnesses the month of Ramadan, meaning Ramadan comes and he's alive, فَلْيَصُمْ, then he has to fast. That also indicates that fasting the month of Ramadan is an obligation. That's from the Quran. From the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسِ. Islam rests on five important matters. شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وإقام الصلاة, praying, performing the prayer, وإيتاء الزكاة, paying the obligatory zakah, وحج البيت, performing pilgrimage, وصوم رمضان. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam counted in this hadith fasting the month of Ramadan as one of those very important matters in Islam. All the scholars of Islam, from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam up to our time, have unanimously agreed that fasting the month of Ramadan is an obligation, as we mentioned, upon the one who is Muslim, pubescent, sane, and able to fast. All of them. Thus, the scholars of Islam said, whoever denies the obligation of fasting is in fact belying the Quran, the Prophet, and contradicting the scholarly consensus. And whoever does that wouldn't be a believer. So let us talk about these conditions one by one. In order for one to be obligated to fast, first, he must be Muslim. Because first, in order for an act of worship to be valid, condition number one is that one has to be Muslim. The act of worship is not valid from other than Muslims. So that's condition number one. Second condition is pubescence. The child is not obligated to fast. Let us say 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, he's not pubescent yet, is not obligated to fast. However, if he has reached 7 lunar years and his body can tolerate fasting, then his parents must order him to fast. That's after 7 lunar years. If his body can tolerate, can withstand fasting, then they tell him to fast. And they also should emphasize on fasting. Not as some ignorant people say, They say to the children at the age of 7 or 8, fast half a day, or up to 12 o'clock, there's no such a thing, that half day fasting. So those people do not emphasize on the issue of fasting, and they will be sinful for ignoring this obligation upon them towards their children. So when a child reaches 7 lunar years and he is of those who have mental discrimination, then his parents would order him to pray and fast if his body can tolerate fasting. They cannot neglect this obligation. So the Muslim, pubescent, sane. This is because the one who is insane is not accountable. Same as the child who has not reached puberty is not accountable. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the hadith, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثَةٍ مِنْهُمُ الصَّبِيُّ وَالْمَجْنُونُ وَالنَّائِمُ. Meaning 3 types of people, while in that state, the pen does not record anything against them. Meaning the angels won't try it. If they commit what is a sin, they don't write it down for them. The child, the insane, and the one who is asleep. Meaning, if let us say someone was asleep, and while being asleep he said something, while not realizing what he's saying, something against the religion, he won't be held accountable for saying these words unintentionally. He won't be held accountable for that. Now the child, if he commits what is a sin, it's the obligation of the guardian to forbid him. So it won't be written against him, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in another hadith, unless this child becomes pubescent, the insane becomes sane, and the one who was asleep wakes up. So while he's asleep, he's not accountable. That means as well, if while being asleep, he didn't wake up for subh prayer, he was in deep sleep, and he woke up in the morning, the sun has risen already, then in that case, this person is not sinful, but he has to make up that prayer. There was a lady at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who complained to the Prophet that her husband does not wake up for subh prayer. He stays asleep. And she used to get frustrated by this. Why doesn't he wake up and pray, but he will be asleep? When she complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet called him. He did not say to him, you are sinful because you did not wake up for subh, because he was asleep. He wasn't accountable at that time. All what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him was, if you wake up, pray. If you wake up for subh, pray. So that's what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught him. As for the one who is unable to fast, in the first place, or he can, but he will harm himself severely due to an old age or a type of sickness that he has no hope of getting recovered from it. Such a person is not obligated to fast. However, he has to pay an expiation, which is one mud for every day. Mud is the average sized hands cupped together, filled with the most common staple food of that region or that area. For instance, in Indonesia and Malaysia, the most common staple food is what? Rice. So that for every day, if someone is living in Indonesia, let us say, his body cannot tolerate fasting because he's at a very old age, or he has a type of sickness where he's most likely won't be recovered from it for the rest of his life. So he cannot fast now, he cannot fast later. Such a person would pay one mud of rice for each day. In most countries, wheat is the most common staple food of the region. In some regions of Ethiopia, the most common staple food is corn. You know, the corn, that's the most common staple food for them. So it differs between one country and another, one region and another, it depends. So one mud, that's called mud, every size hands cupped together, filled with the most common staple food of that region. That's for every day. That's if he cannot fast due an old age or due a sickness from which he does not see any recovery in the future. Meaning most likely he will continue with that sickness for the rest of his life. So those are the conditions that render one obligated to fast. Now we are going to talk about the ability in detail, inshallah azza wa jal, when we talk about the expiation as well. But now we'll talk about the obligations of fasting. Al-Qadi Abu Shuja', may Allah raise his rank, said, the obligations of fasting are five. Intention, to abstain from eating, drinking, and having sexual intercourse, the induced vomit, and being unaware of the beginning and the end of the day. And we'll talk about this shortly, inshallah, azza wa jal. First is the intention. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. Every good deed needs an intention. And fasting is one of the best good deeds. So that's why it needs what? An intention. And the intention must be a night. From sunset till dawn. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ لَمْ يُبَيِّتِ الصِّيَامَ قَبْلَ الْفَجْرِ فَلَا صِيَامَ لَهُ. Whoever does not establish the intention before dawn, then his fasting will be invalid. So you have from sunset till dawn to establish the intention to fast the following day. You don't have to pronounce it by your tongue to utter it. You don't have to. It's enough to pass it on your heart. Meaning, at a time between sunset and dawn, you would have in your heart that intention to fast the following day of Ramadan. Which is very hard to be forgotten. It's very hard to be forgotten to have the intention to fast the following day. Even the scholars said, If you wake up for suhoor, you know, when you wake up at night before dawn, you want to have some food, then you go to the mosque. When you wake up for suhoor, do you usually wake up before dawn and eat in normal days? You don't do this. So why you are waking up at night before dawn and eating? Why? It's because you want to fast the following day. So that act on its own will act as an intention for that person. So as if he intended. Even if at sunset, let us say, after sunset he was eating, breaking his fast, and he said, I want to eat more because today I got tired. He thinks the more he fills up, the more relaxed will be the following day. But he was eating more, and in his heart, because he wants to last the following day. That's an intention. So it's very hard to forget the intention. But he needs to establish the intention in his heart to fast the following day. But I tell you how it might happen that one wouldn't have established the intention at night to fast the following day. Let us say, for instance, they're not sure if tomorrow is the first of Ramadan or the day after. One was tired, he said, maybe I'll wake up at night and check. So he slept, he woke up the following day. At 8 o'clock in the morning, he asked and they told him, that's the first day of Ramadan. So he did not establish the intention at night to fast the following day of Ramadan. This person needs to continue abstaining from all the invalidators of fasting and will have to make up that day after Ramadan. It won't be valid from him. However, Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu gave an exemption for Ramadan. He said the time of intention in Ramadan, not when you are making up a fasting. He said in Ramadan, the time is extended until the time of the noon prayer. So from sunset till the noon prayer, which is more than the time allocated by Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. So according to Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, if one woke up in the morning in Ramadan, first day, and they told him Ramadan has started and he hasn't eaten and he didn't drink anything yet since the morning, he can establish the intention after he woke up to fast that day of Ramadan. According to Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu and some others, every day is a separate act of worship. Not the whole month. So every day is separate. And they stated that if one breaks the fasting of one day, the rest of the days are valid. So that's why they are not connected. It's not like the prayer, when you are praying four rak'ahs, if you do an invalidator of prayer in the first rak'ah, the whole prayer is invalid. If you do an invalidator of the prayer in the third rak'ah, the whole prayer is invalid because they are connected. But fasting the whole month of Ramadan, they said it's not connected, each day separate. That's why, according to the school of Imam al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, every day needs an intention. Every day. So each night, one needs to establish the intention to fast the following day. Now after establishing the intention, he can go to sleep. And if he eats or drinks, or has sexual intercourse after establishing the intention to fast the following day, this does not affect the validity of his intention. And they also mentioned that if he established the intention simultaneously with the setting in of the dawn prayer, time of the dawn prayer, at the same time, the time has set in for the dawn prayer and he was establishing the intention at the same time, that's invalid because he did not establish the intention before dawn. That's according to Imam Al-Shafi'i radiallahu anhu. They also said that the best type of intention is to have in your heart the intention to fast the following day of Ramadan as an obligation this year for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is to abstain from the invalidators of fasting. So one has to abstain from eating and drinking even a little amount. If one eats or drinks intentionally, a little amount that invalidates his fast. And also what is similar to eating and drinking, it doesn't have to be actual eating or drinking. If you inhale something into your body cavity, to the head or to the stomach, from an open inlet, that invalidates your fast. And let me explain this for you. What goes into your body cavity, they mean to the stomach or to the lungs or to the head, from an open inlet, meaning if someone sniffs drugs, for instance, the drugs from his nose will go up to his head. It won't go down to his stomach, so that invalidates his fast. If someone inhales a medicine through his mouth, that invalidates his fast as well, such as the puffer for those suffering from asthma. It invalidates their fast. Some of them would use another device, such as the ventilator, for instance, with medicine, and the medicine keeps going inside. That's why they feel relaxed when they use it, because it goes inside to the lungs. So they inhale these particles inside the body cavity, into the body cavity through an open inlet, so it invalidates one's fast. If someone says that puffer does not invalidate one's fast because it's not food, same with smoking. It's not food, he's not eating, but why it invalidates his fast? Because when one smokes a cigarette, those little particles will separate from it, will go inside. So he is inhaling these particles into his body cavity through an open inlet, that invalidates his fast. They also mention that if he uses ear drops, for instance, and they pass the ear canal, go inside, that invalidates his fast. Even if one would, let us say, insert something in his ear that would go through the canal of his ear, that invalidates his fast. Because that hole you see in the ear, in Arabic they call this as-simakh, anything passes that point and goes inside, invalidates one's fast. So if one has eardrops, if you use the eardrops, after you use these drops in your ear, you can feel the taste in your throat. So there is an open passage, goes inside to your throat, and that will go to your stomach. So that's an open inlet. But using the kuhul in the eye does not invalidate one's fast because the eye is not an open inlet. Although sometimes you might put eye drops, you might feel some of the taste in your throat. Maybe it absorbs, but it's not an open inlet. That's why the eye is different from the E. They also gave an example about, for instance, if someone asked for a tube to go into his stomach from outside, from his stomach, they put it inside, he asked for it to be done, or he put it himself, it went to the body cavity, then that invalidates one's fast. That is different from, let us say, stabbing himself with a knife in his hand or in his shin, for instance. That's not the body cavity. So that's why all these drips they use now, this does not invalidate one's fast, because that injection is not going into the body cavity. So keep that in mind. But if he is injecting a medicine into the body cavity through an open inlet, that invalidates his fast. Like using some suppositories, let us say, for instance, in one's bottom to go inside his stomach, that invalidates his fast. Because he's using that open inlet to insert that medicine inside and it will reach his body cavity. That invalidates his fast. But some people would ask about making a blood test. See how they take some blood from his vein. So they actually put the needle in the vein and they take some blood out for testing. This does not invalidate one's fast. Even if they put the drip for him in the vein, this does not invalidate his fast as well. If they give him injection in the muscle, this does not invalidate his fast because that won't go to the body cavity through an open inlet. The blood that comes out of the gum gets mixed with your saliva, you cannot swallow it while fasting. You have to spit it out. This saliva that is contaminated with blood, you have to spit it out. You can't just swallow it. That invalidates your fast. So you have to clean your mouth thoroughly if you are suffering from that bleeding in Ramadan. Let us say you spit and you see the blood, you keep spitting, then it stopped. Once it stops, now the saliva inside your mouth is contaminated, has become najis, filthy, because of what? Of the blood. So you need to rinse your mouth with water, then you can swallow your saliva that is clear of being contaminated with blood. If someone wakes up in the morning and he swallows his saliva, after he swallows his saliva, he feels a different taste. Then he spits out, he finds that there is blood mixed with his saliva. Now his fasting has been invalidated. However, because he didn't know that his saliva was mixed with blood, he's not sinful. But he has to make up this day. He needs to continue this day as if he is fasting, but he has to make it up later on. This is something that many people might be inflicted with in Ramadan. Same with the phlegm that comes out of the chest. Also, that happens to many people. If it goes up, passes the exit of letter Ha, that means now it has reached the mouth. So you need to spit it out. If you swallow it intentionally, that invalidates your fast. However, according to Imam Abu Hanifa and Malik, may Allah raise their ranks, they said this phlegm is something commonly experienced by many people, and there is a hardship for them, so that is exempted. According to them, even if that phlegm goes up to the mouth, then you swallow it, your fasting is still valid. Your saliva, as long as it is inside the mouth, it doesn't matter how many times you swallow it, this won't affect your fasting. But if it comes out as an entity, meaning there is a volume for it, I'm not talking about the wetness, like if one licks his lips while fasting, what is on the lip now is wetness. This does not affect one's fast. Even if he licks his lip again and again and again, this does not invalidate his fast. But we are talking about accumulated saliva. If that accumulated saliva dangles out the mouth, then one takes his tongue out and grab him and swallow him, because they separated from his mouth, now he grabbed them from outside into inside and swallowed them, that invalidates his fast. But as I mentioned, just keep that in mind. Licking your lips does not invalidate your fast, because there is no saliva accumulated. That is called wetness only on your saliva. It doesn't affect your fast. If someone forgot that he was fasting and ate and drank during the day of fasting, his fasting is still valid. Even if he ate to the full, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man nasiya wa huwa sa'im fa akala aw shariba." Whoever forgets while fasting, so he eats or drinks, "Falyutimma sawmah," let him continue his fast, فَإِنَّمَا أَطْعَمَهُ اللَّهُ وَسَقَاهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed for him to eat and drink while forgetting. So even if he had the intention, he woke up in the morning, he forgot that he is in Ramadan, for instance. He made his breakfast, he ate, he drank, then he went to his work. While talking with his friends, they reminded him that today is the first day of fasting, let us say. And he had the intention to fast, but he forgot. His fast is still valid, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. One has to abstain from having sexual intercourse because this invalidates one's fast, or to cause the emission of the seminal liquid through a contact. This also invalidates one's fast. And the induced vomit, the one who forces himself to vomit. You know, some people might eat different types of food before dawn, sweet and salty and bitter and mixed together. Then after dawn, they feel uncomfortable at all. They need to throw them out in order to be relieved. But if they force themselves to vomit by, for instance, putting the finger inside the mouth, or using a feather, put it inside the mouth on the tongue so they can throw up, if that happens and they did that on purpose, this invalidates the fast, because it's induced vomit. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man zara'ahu al-qay' wa huwa sa'im." Yani he was overcome by vomit, wasn't induced vomit, was involuntarily he vomited, let him continue his fast, he doesn't have to make it up. But whoever induced vomit, he has to make up that day. The last one is to be aware of the beginning and the end of fasting. Because fasting the month or fasting the day is from dawn till sunset, one has to make sure that he is not eating after dawn and he's not eating or drinking before sunset. That means if one, let us say, woke up in the morning, looked at the watch, he thought it's 4, when in fact it was 5. He thought it's 4. He got up and he drank some water. Then he found out later it was 5 and already subah started. In such a case, he has to make up that day because he drank water after dawn. So he has to make sure that he is fasting between the beginning and the end of the time, between dawn and sunset. Sometimes some people might think that Maghrib has set in. Maghrib has set in, so they start eating and drinking, then they find out, no, it hasn't started yet. You know, as some people, like they did that in the past, they turn on the TV and listening to this channel or that channel, and one of them put the azan, so he started eating. It turned up to be for a different country. So they ate and drank before sunset, then that day has been invalidated, they have to make it up. So you have to make sure that you are fasting from dawn till sunset. Inshallah, tabaraka wa ta'ala, we'll continue explaining these matters. We'll talk about the invalidators of fasting, inshallah, azza wa jal, next week, and other matters, and about zakah maybe. Yeah, all what you are expected to be, or that you should be aware of, during the month of Ramadan, we'll explain them, inshallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. We say La ilaha illallah 3 times.